just a rabbi. Sold I to the merchant ships. Minutes after they took I from the bottomless pit. But my hand was made strong by the hand of the Almighty. We forward in this generation triumphantly. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever have, redemption songs, redemption songs. Emancipate yourselves from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. Have no fear for atomic energy, 'cause none of them can stop the time. How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Some say it's just a part of it. We've got to fulfill the book. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever have, redemption songs, redemption songs, redemption songs. Emancipate yourselves from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our mind. Oh, have no fear for atomic energy, 'cause none of them can stop at the time. How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Yes, some say it's just a part of it. We've got to fulfill the book. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever have, redemption songs. All I ever have, redemption songs. These songs of freedom, songs of freedom.
What a wonderful world. of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky. Also on the faces of people passing by, see friends shaking hands, singing, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you.
Everybody gonna save theirself, make the coolie on a pono for help the other one. And when you make the coolie on a, you know, pono, then it's going, it's like kind of automatic climber. You don't need talk, the stuff going happen. And you just gotta let them, and the stuff just waiting for when you ready.
Of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky. Also on the faces of people passing by, see friends shaking hands, singing, how do you do? They really say, I love you. Then we'll know, and think to myself.
whose wisdom is beyond our understanding, deal gracious with your servants David and Laura and David in their grief. Surround them with your love, that they may not be overwhelmed by their loss, but have confidence in your goodness and strength to meet the days to come, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Please be seated for the week.
Death is nothing at all. I have only slipped away to the next room. I am I, and you are you. Whatever we were to each other, that we still are. Call me by my old familiar name. Speak to me in the easy way which you always use. Put no difference into your tone. Wear no forced air of solemnity or sorrow. Laugh as we have always laughed at the little jokes we enjoyed together. Play, smile, think of me, pray for me. Let my name be ever the household word that it always was. Let it be spoken without effect, without the trace of a shadow on it. Life means all that it ever meant. It is the same that it ever was. There is absolute and unbroken continuity. Why should I be out of mind if I am out of sight? I am but waiting for you, for an interval, somewhere very near, just around the corner, all is well.
Laura asked me to read the Serenity Prayer. You know the first half, but you can say it along with me. God, grant me serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardships as the pathway to peace, taking as He did the sinful world as it is, not as I would have it, trusting that He will make all things right if I surrender to His will, that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with Him forever in the next. Now the three points of the first part of the prayer, courage, or serenity, courage, and wisdom, are found from the Bible. The request for serenity from God is a common theme in Scripture. For example, Christ Himself promises peace to His followers. In John 14:27, He says, "Peace is what I leave with you. It is my own peace that I give you. I do not give it as the world does. Do not be worried and upset. Do not be afraid." And as Paul the Apostle, when writing to the church in Philippi, implies that the peace of God comes when we have given all our anxious thoughts to God in prayer. He writes in Philippians 4, "In nothing be anxious, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your thoughts in Christ Jesus." The second request, for courage. There is a promise in Scripture from the writings of the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah writes in chapter 41, "Do not be afraid, for I am with you. Don't be discouraged, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will hold you up with my victorious right hand." In the letter to James, we are encouraged to ask God for the third attribute, wisdom, and He will give generously. As James says, "If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously in all, without finding fault, and it will be given to you." The second prayer that Laura asked me to talk about or read was the prayer of St. Francis. And it's known as the Peace Prayer of St. Francis. And
this, I found out that St. Francis didn't write it. It was published in 1912 in France. I'm credit to the French. But anyway, a Catholic priest wrote it in 1912 or thereabouts. It says, "Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, and it is in pardoning that we are pardoned. And it is in dying that we are born to eternal life." John 6:35-40. Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me, and still you do not believe. And those the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all those that he has given me, but raise them up at the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day." A few words from that were written by a classmate of mine by the name of Ron Rollhauser. He's a Catholic priest, dean of the School of Theology down in Dallas, Texas. So these aren't my words. I'm plagiarizing. He writes, "When someone is stricken with cancer, one of three things can happen. One, sometimes doctors can treat the disease and in essence cure it. Two, sometimes the medical professionals cannot cure the disease, but can control it enough so the person suffering from cancer can live with the disease for the rest of his life or her life. And three, sometimes, however, the cancer is a kind that cannot be treated. All the medicine and treatments in the world are powerless, and the person passes away. Certain kinds of emotional depression work the same way. One, sometimes they can be treated so that in effect the person is cured. Two, sometimes they cannot ever really be cured, but they can be treated in such a way that the person can live with the disease for his or her whole life. Or three, and sometimes, just as with certain kinds of cancer, the disease is untreatable, unstoppable, no intervention by anyone or anything can halt its advance. Eventually, it kills the person and there is nothing anyone can do. Now we know depression is a disease, something that in some cases a person out of life against his, or takes a person out of life against his or her will. The emotional equivalent of cancer, a stroke, or a heart attack. In addition, the loved ones who remain should not spend undue time and energy second-guessing as to how we might have failed that person, what we should have noticed, and what we might have still done to prevent the tragedy. It is an illness, and with a purely physical disease, we can love someone and still not be able to save him or her from death. The person is too bruised and oversensitive to have the resiliency needed to continue to cope with life. In these cases, the cause of death can pretty accurately be termed as emotional cancer. Just as with physical cancer, the person dying of emotional cancer is taken out of life against his or her will. God loved Brian, and like us, could not interfere with his free will. Finally, we shouldn't worry too much about God, how God meets Brian on the other side. God's love, unlike ours, goes through locked doors, descends into the deepest reaches of our souls, and breathes out peace where we can't. Brian passed away from this tragic disease and awoke on the other side to find Christ standing inside his locked door, inside the heart of his chaos, breathing out peace and gently saying, "Peace be with you." We see in the resurrection appearances of Jesus, God's love and compassion are not rendered helpless by locked doors. He passed right through them. Laura has received a lot of support from her family and friends, and here's one she especially loved. This message to Laura is from Victoria. She says, "I'm picturing Brian in God's arms. He's looking up saying, 'I tried so hard.' And stroking Brian's hair, God says, 'I know you did, and you're home with me now, so rest peacefully.'" Victoria truly believes that Brian's tortured spirit is finally at peace. And Victoria is absolutely correct. Brian is at peace and reveling in the joy of the Lord. Let us rejoice with him and for Brian's newfound peace and love. For it's a fact that we'll all be with him very soon. We pray for Brian and his family, left to remember him as he really was, a child of God and an heir of heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Brian was the quintessential baby of the family, a beautiful charmer. I often said he was my favorite family member, and I strongly suspect he was all of ours. He was overwhelmingly popular in school as well. Some teachers may have thought a little too popular for no good. Brian's natural gift with people was due, I think, to his easy acceptance of everyone from all walks of life, and a certain vulnerability that others saw in Brian. He was constantly surrounded by groups of friends, many of whom stood by his side throughout his life, offering their loyalty and support. To those friends, we thank you for being here today, for Brian, as you continue to act as the supportive and dear companions that you are. He loved you, and in return, you provided him with one of life's most precious experiences, true friendship. How proud we all were when Brian struck out on his own to California to make his childhood dream of becoming a professional skateboarder a reality. It didn't take long before well-known national sponsors were claiming him, and he was appearing on the cover of magazines, featured in videos, his childhood dream realized. As his family, we were proud, but truthfully, not all that surprised. Brian was extremely talented, likable, and fearless, a powerful combination. Laura and David, please be comforted that in the fact that he felt very loved and supported by you always. Your actions as you guided and cared for Brian, myself, David, and many others considered to be heroic. I often wondered if I would have your strength and decided many times that I would have fallen short of your exemplary and admirable example of true unconditional parental love. I offer a simple but deeply meaningful thank you from Brian because I feel like he would have wanted me to do so. Although it was difficult and painful to watch as Brian struggled these last few years, we consider ourselves lucky and blessed to have been his family. We hold his dear, sweet memory in our hearts, and will think of him often as we continue on our own individual journeys, ever hopeful of seeing him once again.
When I think of Brian, I get two images always. One is the adult Brian, being a strong guy with broad shoulders and hair growing out of his chin, and often his knees incomprehensibly close to that chin. But also, if you watch the slideshow, I always get images of him as a young boy, with a halo of golden hair, and piercing eyes, and a smile on his face. I was looking at pictures today, always smiles. And a lot of times, smiles but lips were closed. His eyes were brilliant, and there was always so much going on behind them. I always wanted to know more of what was in there. But I think a lot of times he kept his cards close to his chest. There's so many friends. If you're like me, we lost him too soon, and you wish you knew him better. But what he shared with you, if you know his passions and his fears, the things he abided and the things he couldn't abide, that's sacred knowledge. It means that he loved you because he shared it with you. And I hope you'll treasure that. My brother and I, we were the Virginia cousins. We used to come about once a year. I'm 7.5 years older, so when I was 12 or 13, once a year or so, we could get to know Cousin David pretty well. The Star Wars figurines, and he liked soccer, and what he did in school, and at the beach and the water, and the music that he liked, that incomprehensible hair metal phase you went through in the 80s. If Brian shared that with you, opened himself to you, the things that moved him, the things that moved his spirit, that's sacred. This room is full of people who appear to have that sacred knowledge. Brian was an English major. I know this more from Uncle Dave than from Brian. Dave used to tell me, I think, hoping for comfort. Miles, my son is an English major. Please tell me this. And then a little more urgently, Miles, if you could get a real job just to show that it can be done, an English major. Wordsworth said, child is father of the man, which means we grow up, we get older, but we're so much the way we were even as very young children, that the apple of adulthood does not fall far from the childhood tree. And when I see pictures of that young Brian, I think it's true. There's such a sweetness. Sometimes an unbridled joy in those pictures, but also sometimes I sense a sadness behind those eyes. And when we lose someone too young, we wonder what was going on behind those eyes. Was he shy or was he terrified? If he shared his joys and his fears with you, the things he loved and he couldn't abide, that meant you were very special to him. And I hope you will treasure his sacred knowledge.
Today we're here to honor the life of Brian Cox Childers. Our family has had the pleasure of knowing Brian at a very early age. Even at this time, you know, Brian had a lust for life. Before skateboarding became his dream, there was break dancing, skateboarding, fishing, and soccer. Whatever activity it was, Brian would give his all. And typically, he stood out amongst the rest. Brian had many friends, as you can see, and all the people here today. But I don't think there were any as close to him as his best friend, his dog, Breaker. Breaker was named for his favorite hobby at the time, which was breakdancing. As long as I can remember, if you were Brian, Breaker was there by his side. Brian had a huge heart and loved his dog dearly. I recall when Brian was quite young, he came over to our house with my brother Matt. I picked up a hobby of skateboarding and was outside trying to learn some tricks. Brian, being full of life and adventurous, asked us if he could try. And I believe it was on the second or third try that he had landed the trick that I've been working on all day. It wasn't long after this, the next time I saw him, Brian had a skateboard. And he had already mastered several tricks and was doing things my friends and I couldn't even do. I could tell at a very young age, Brian was an exceptional athlete. Had uncanny physical abilities and was destined to go on to do something special. Brian also loved being out on the water fishing. There were many days and nights spent hanging out on the dock, out there on the river. We would often wade the shoreline, fishing Raggedy Point, or out in his Boston. side. Oftentimes after school, we'd run over to the house, jump in the boat or jump in the water, and fish until the sun went down. I have many great memories hanging out on the St. John's with no worries, no pressures of life at that time. Ryan also enjoyed surfing, and we had some great times surfing behind his beach house in Palm Beach, as well as St. Augustine and other areas. Ryan was always up for a road trip to go surfing, see his favorite band, or whatever else. Ryan was a natural and gifted athlete, and those talents allowed him to do what he loved in skateboarding, chasing his dream. I believe a lot of his friends were more excited than he was when he was able to realize that dream. But Brian was a humble person. He had an infectious personality and a contagious laugh. He was outgoing and friendly, had a huge heart and a peaceful soul. Brian was well respected and liked, and this was evident and really set in while I was on the computer the other night. I saw the outpouring of love and support and sorrow over social media. Not long ago, our family went through an unfortunate situation, and Brian and Ms. Childers came out there in our support, not because they had to, because that's who they are. This is Brian. We came here to pay our respects to and support his family today. I know each person here has been touched by Brian, and there are many other stories and memories of a good time spent together. I am thankful for having the opportunity to know him and often look back to those silent days as my brother. As my brother Matt said, I can see Brian, I'll lean over the pearly gates, finding his dog Breaker and rolling around on the ground just like old times. May he rest in peace.
Let me tell you about my friend. He was kind of like a fictitious character in a novel or in a movie. He was the character that all the girls fell in love with, that was tall, handsome, and all the guys loved to be around. He was the coolest guy in the school. You know, the one that every single thing he did, he was amazing at. Imagine a character that had unrealistically pulsating, shiny, bright blue eyes, unlike you would ever see in a real person. But of course, the character was real. And his name is Brian Childers. And he was my friend for almost 30 years of my life. We spent the millennium New Year's Eve together. We lived together. We went on crazy road trips that are worthy of a movie. We drove through deserts. We went to big cities. We talked deeply about our lives and what mattered to us. But the one thing that I can say about Brian is that he lived. And he didn't live an ordinary life. And he loved deeply and passionately. He loved so much that most people would never feel that much inside of them. And I know how much his life mattered, because if you look around the room, it's there right in front of you. And every day, I thank God. And today, I say thank you, God, for the life of Brian Childers.
Good words by good people, powerful and meaningful. Thank you. Thank you very much. It is written in the Talmud that if we cannot share our tears, our bones will turn to dust. And let there be no dusty bones here. The family encourages all of you to remain after the service and join with them for reception, where we can share Brian's stories. And you all have them, and as we've heard. And so please be open and share those words with one another, as well as our tears. Laura and David and members of the family, our hearts break with yours. And there are no easy answers, no answers at all, really. One might, in the dark night of the soul, say, where was God when Brian anguished and struggled in his death? And the answer is, God was in the same place he was when his own son was anguished and dead. We do not know the mysteries of life. No one really knows what happens after we die. Only one person has been there and come back to tell us about it. He didn't say much. He just promised that there was a lot of room. There are many rooms. It's a roomy, big place. Now inhabited by Brian. Roomy place. I want to share with you a prayer that I've always loved. And it didn't seem to make the last cut of the prayer book. Either because sophisticated theologians thought it was bad theology, or some people thought it might have been too schmaltzy. And I've always loved it and treasured it. It was something like this. We seem to give him back to you, dear Lord, who gave us unto us. But you did not give him you did not lose him in the giving, and we have not lost him by his return. For death is but a horizon, and a horizon is the limit of our vision. Lift us up, therefore, strong Son of God, that we may see more clearly and know more dearly our beloved to be with you in your presence. I've always liked that prayer. I think it's appropriate at this time. Let us now say our concluding prayers and the commendation. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, whose days are without end and whose mercies cannot be numbered, make us, we pray, deeply aware of the shortness and uncertainty of human life. And let your Holy Spirit lead us in our holiness and righteousness all the days of our life, that when we shall have served you in this generation, we may be gathered with our ancestors, having received the testimony of a good conscience in the commission of the Holy Catholic Church, in the confidence of a certain faith, and in the comfort of a religious and holy hope, in favor with you, our God, and in perfect charity with the world. And all of this we ask through through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, by your death you took away the sting of death. Grant to us, your servants, to follow in faith where you have led the way, that we may at length fall asleep peacefully in you and wake up in your likeness, for your tender mercy's sake. Father of all, we pray to you for those we love but no longer see. Grant them your peace. Let light perpetual shine upon them, and in your loving wisdom and almighty power, work in them the good purpose of your perfect will, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant, O Lord, to all of us who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage, we may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, and sorrow, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And all this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Give rest, O Christ, your servant, with your saints, where sighing and sorrow are no more, neither pain but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of all mankind, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and of the earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave, we make our song, Hallelujah, Hallelujah, Hallelujah. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. And into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Brian. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed company of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. And now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Injured.